calming to what it's going to look like, so it helps. Okay, we're going to do a quick review. Let me move this so you guys can actually see it. Is it visible for everybody right now, the way it is? Over a little bit more? Better or worse?
You can see it.
I can't remember where I had it last week. Was it back there?
It was a little bit there, but it doesn't matter to me.
Is that okay for you guys? Can you see better? Okay. All right, so let's do that. Very quick review. Early labor. Tell me what's happening in the cervix.
Softening.
Yeah, softens. Effacement is like the workhorse of early labor, right? Effacement is totally what's happening in a first-time mom, especially, okay? And that's like kind of a big deal. What else does the cervix do in the first like little part of labor or big part of labor?
Ripens.
Yeah, absolutely. That's like the main thing it's doing, yep. Okay. And it's opening?
Forward.
Yep, perfect. And then, yeah, you guys have all the answers. And then it does dilate to...
3 centimeters.
Yeah, perfect, yeah. So we'll say 0 to 3 centimeters. The contractions are lasting how long each contraction lasts?
45 seconds.
Yep, 30 to 45 seconds. So if we remember, the peaks are gonna be real short, right? If there's a pinch there, it's gonna be pretty short. So that's the great thing. And those contractions, the how often they're coming is?
30 minutes.
Yeah, like, we'll say 5 to 20 minutes, okay? And then mom's mood is?
Happy.
Yeah, like cheerful, excited, right? So we'll say like positive, cheerful mood. Kind of like a little anxious, butterflies, that kind of feeling, right? What is the main task of early labor for both of you guys?
Keep busy.
Yep, I call it
kill time,
okay? I cannot emphasize this more. You do not want to like pay too much attention because it'll take forever. Like the more you pay attention to it, the longer it's gonna feel. You just wanna keep busy, like he said. Just, you know, make yourself comfortable and happy, have some laughs, do things you enjoy, you know, have fun. And don't forget, what's our overnight plan? Tell me more about our overnight plan.
Taking a bath.
Yeah, take a bath. What else?
Either tea or have a glass of red wine.
Yeah, or any wine, yeah. Just whatever's gonna, not necessarily red, but whatever you like. And just to, it'll just kind of dial back the contractions and relax you and help you get a little more rest, especially since you haven't been drinking very much. It'll really, really relax you. And then remember, you're gonna even pretend to sleep. Even if you're not able to really sleep, pretending to sleep buys you energy on the other end when you're pushing and you're so exhausted. You'd be like, I'm so glad I slept that period of time and rested my body because I'm working like an athlete right now, right? So, okay, that's perfect, you guys. So that covers a plan for early labor. And how long does this whole enchilada last?
Day.
Yep, we're gonna plan on a whole day. Worst case scenario, 2 days, but like that would be like when the contractions are 20 minutes apart, you know what I mean? But usually this is gonna take up a whole day. We're just gonna be ready to hit it with like entertaining ourselves basically, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, we're moving on to the next phase, which was called?
Active labor.
Yep, active. Tell me 2 criteria to know we've moved into active labor.
Can't talk.
Yes. Do you remember that? She cannot walk or talk through the contractions. In between the contractions, she's totally normal. But during the contractions, cannot walk or talk. That's number one. Okay?
Code yellow will 317 central power. Code yellow will 317
central power. Okay. What's the number 2 thing that is my idea that you're in active labor? Do you remember that one?
If the mother says so.
That was when to leave for the hospital.
Oh.
I want you to think about moving from the early labor, remember, to the more heavy duty active labor.
Oh, it was a time.
Yes.
35 minutes, I think, for...
Anyone else? He's warm. It was how long the contraction lasted.
30 seconds?
It has to be at least a minute, okay? At least 1 minute, okay? 60 seconds or more. If you're having heavy duty contractions, but they're only 40 seconds, guess what, they're not dilating you. I'm just telling you, they're not. Like, they're probably thinning you if they're 40 seconds long, but they're not lasting long enough to really pull that turtleneck sweater back over that baby's head. So we need them to last a minute to hold, to like really do that action that we needed to do, okay? So that's active labor. The contractions are how close together? Someone else said it.
That was 3 to 5 minutes?
Yep, that's it. 3 to 5 minutes apart, those contractions. Those contractions are at least 60 seconds long or more. And then what's the mom's mood?
Anxious?
Yeah.
Nervous?
Like, just remember. Go ahead, please.
I said irritable last time, but I think.
Yeah, I like it.
Okay.
I like that.
I think it's
so,
just me, probably.
No. That's real. Because remember, she's like, shut up. You know what I mean? It's because it takes all of her energy to just get through that contraction. She needs to totally concentrate and focus. So I'm going to write down concentration. Okay. I'm going to write down turning inward. So this is where you're going to see the lady, like, kind of, like, closing her eyes more. Like, she's going to kind of bow her head and close her eyes. Like, she's going to be into herself. Like, really focused on staying on top of this, okay? And she might be more irritable. Okay, so here's a little coaching point for you. If she becomes, like, a little bit, you know, like in the movies, the woman's like, I hate you, and, like, you did this to me. Like, I'm here to tell you that's not real. Like, women don't really do that. That's, like, stupid drama for movies. Like, you don't all of a sudden, because you're in labor, like, hate your partner. That's not real. But I'll tell you something, like, imagine if you're trying to lift a piano and someone keeps tapping you on the shoulder going, excuse me. Like, what are you going to say to them if you're in the middle of lifting a piano? You're going to be like, hang on a second. You know what I mean? Same thing. So it's not, like, never personal towards you, but, like, imagine if you're lifting a piano and someone's interrupting you, what that would be like. That's all it is. So that irritability is just kind of like, I'm really like doing everything I can here right now. It feels like digging a ditch. It's hard work. Like, give me a second and then I'll be right with you, you know? Because in between the contractions, remember, she's totally normal again. Isn't that weird? Like, she makes jokes, she's herself. But during those contractions, it's like lifting the piano. Okay, so here's a thing that I see a lot of partners do, okay? So when she starts to be like that during the contractions, they take it onto themselves that they're being annoying or that they're doing something she doesn't like. And they're kind of thinking to themselves, I should just like get out of here because I'm just bugging her. But nothing could be farther from the truth, okay? I'm here to tell you guys, this is a real secret of labor, okay? This is honest. Her greatest fear in labor is that you will leave her. Like, when she's going through that moment, the thing she needs and wants the most from you is to just like, hang, just stay with her. Like, she doesn't need you to do something, but just like for you to just even stand by and just like witness what she's going through, it's everything, okay? So kind of what I see some partners doing when the woman's going through some of this stuff and starting to get like showing a little irritability is they start to back away. They start to like take steps, they physically like start to distance themselves from her. And I'm here to tell you, if you really want to help her, like, I promise she doesn't want you to step away. Just stay an arm's length away. Just like, you don't have to say anything. You don't have to do anything. The greatest comfort, like, you don't have to learn a massage technique. You don't have to learn the perfect thing to say. If you do stay with her, she'll love you forever. Like, that is it. It's just hanging out with her while she goes through this is everything. So another thing I see, like, sometimes in the hospital room, okay? So here's the guy, right? She's sitting on the bed. She's going through a contraction, she's breathing hard. He's holding her hands, right? He's whispering like sweet nothings, really nice things to her. We can't even hear what they're saying. Their heads are together, right? And then they're like having this really sweet moment. Well, the staff, we walk in, right? And here's what the guy does. Like, we're walking toward the bed, the doctor and the nurse. Guess what the guy does? He goes like this. He goes and he stands in the corner of the room. You know what I mean? But here's what I want you to know. When they come in, that's when she needs you to be right there by her side. Like, your job is to be right by her side. Our job is to work around you because you're the person who belongs there. It's your child, your family, right? So whatever's going on, like, you can just be with her and stay with her, and like, you don't have to get out of the way. You're not in the way. That's what I want you to know, okay? So this is like, can be hard on you as the partner, because that's one of the things you're like, am I bothering her? But I promise you're actually not bothering her. It just, it can feel like that, but we're gonna talk in this class and next class about like real things you can do to comfort her and just help her through it, okay? So that's what we mean when we see that like irritable mood. It's just like, it's taking all she's got to like just push through. Okay, how long does this whole enchilada last, this phase?
That one's 12 hours?
Right? Good, thank you. Because the video is, they're liars, right?
Yeah.
So the video said 6 hours, but for a first-time mom, I'm gonna say 6 to 12 hours for this phase, okay? Because it just takes you time to work through and open that cervix. It just takes some time and it takes some work. But the cool thing is, like, don't forget, girls, you're spending more time resting than you're spending working. You know, do not forget that. That's how you get through it. Is you just really do rest more than you work, okay? All right, so that was active labor, perfect. So now I want to introduce you to the next phase, which we didn't really review last time, and it's kind of crucial. And it's especially crucial for the mamas who have a preference not to use pain medication, okay? Because this is the part where kind of the wheels fall off and everything kind of goes to hell. I'm not gonna lie. Okay. So do you guys remember what the next phase after active labor was called?
Transition.
Yeah, it was. It was transition. You got it. Okay. Okay. Do you guys remember in the first class when we were talking about the uterus, in the beginning of labor, it's all pulling upward. Do you remember that? Then in the middle somewhere, it has to switch directions and start pushing down. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
This is transition. And in order to accomplish that huge shift in the dynamics of the uterus, guess what? She gets this huge dump of hormones. And it feels weird. And it feels a little scary because there's big things happening in her body. So up until now, it's been like pretty steady of like oxytocin, endorphins. Well, in order to accomplish transition, which is the last hurrah, right? Because what's her cervix doing? How far did her cervix get in active labor?
3 to 7.
You're right, exactly, okay? So we start transition at 7 centimeters, we're going all the way to 10, all the way to the end, and the baby's starting to push out, okay? So in order to accomplish that, her body's like tired now, because she's been at it now for a day, day and a half. So now her body's starting to be like, blah, like I have to do what now? I'm tired. So guess what she needs? Adrenaline. What does adrenaline feel like? Kind of good, kind of crappy. Like adrenaline gives you energy, but it makes you feel jittery and scared, right, and weird. So transition feels kind of like you're lost. And I don't want to like identify it with something that doesn't fit, but like the only thing I could really think of, I don't know if any of you ladies could relate with this, but like, have you ever felt like that kind of PMS feeling where you don't know if you want to laugh or cry, you don't know if you want to hug someone or slap someone, you don't know what, like you just don't feel right? That's kind of the feeling that you get with this hormone wave of transition, okay? You just feel kind of weird and lost, okay? And it's everything right happening because that means you got that adrenaline surge. Catecholamines are starting to wake up your baby's body so when it comes out it could breathe, okay? So those things are needed, but man, they feel weird and they feel different than you normally feel, okay? And so transition, it's, tell me what contractions, like how close together they are, do you remember? They're like 2 to 3 minutes apart, okay? Do you remember how long they lasted, anyone?
They lasted like a minute too.
Yeah, yep, 90 seconds, okay? So now, You're getting close where you're working as much as you're resting. Wow, that's the hardest part. You see that? This is heavy duty stuff now, and the contractions are squeezing you really hard. But guess what? You got that adrenaline on board to help you and to bring you some energy and push you through to the end. And it feels weird and scary, like jittery, anxious. Ah, what's happening to me? And guess what happens? If a woman hasn't gotten an epidural yet at this point, there's a natural emotional event that happens every time. It's called the self-doubt signpost. I can't emphasize this enough. What does the self-doubt signpost look like? Her face gets worried and sad, and she goes, I don't think I can do this. I don't know how much longer I could do this. I don't want to let you down, but I don't want to finish this. I want to go home. I want my mommy. Like, self-doubt. I'm not strong enough. I'm not good enough. Any of those things, you know what me and the midwife or the doctor do? We give each other a high five because we're almost done. We know right away, she knows too. We know right away when the mother panics a bit like that and she's emotional, we're like, we're right there. Boom, we're about to push. We get excited. There's excitement in the room. We're like, the right things are happening. So we look, so how do you coach this? Okay, I'm gonna visit this a little bit today. We're gonna revisit again next week because it's kind of crucial, okay? Because she's kind of falling apart on you. And what are you gonna do, okay? So, think about, I want you to think about, like, did anyone ever take a cruise on a cruise ship? Okay, she did. Okay, so did you guys see Titanic?
Yeah.
Okay, then you're with me. Okay, so imagine you're on a cruise ship with your honey, okay? And it's at night, and you're out on the deck, like, you know, whatever it's called. And then, like, you're taking pictures because it's a beautiful night. And you're taking a picture of her, and she's kind of leaning on the railing, and then her little purse she's holding, it falls on the ledge right there, so she reaches over to grab it, and she falls overboard. Okay? Yeah. So, what happens is her body, like, you're many stories up, you see her body just falling through the air, and then she's gonna hit the water from way high, right? So the first thing you're thinking is, like, is she dead? Did she make it after she hit the water? That's your first thought. And then you think to yourself, like, this whole ship is moving. You can't stop it. And you're kind of helpless. And you're like, you're yelling for help. So would you, like, take your eyes off of her? Like, no, right? You'd be leaning over trying to find her head coming up above the water, right? You're just going to search the water for her. And just think in your mind, like, if you could yell something down to her, like, her head surfaces, you see her face, what would you say? What would you say in that moment? When it's like, the situation's bigger than you, you want to help her. Are you going to say, oh, poor you, it looks pretty cold down there? Like, no. You're going to be like, you got to swim. We're going to get you out of there. You're going to be warm soon. Keep fighting. Keep kicking. Come on. You can do this. Right? That's what you're going to say. You're not going to, like, all of a sudden get into, like, a pity moment. You're just going to be like, okay, we're doing this. We're finishing this. I want you to also think of, like sports psychology, right? So, not like a very sporty person, but imagine, like, you're on a team, right? And then there's one player that you really need, but they get an injury. And, you know, you kind of wrap their ankle or something. And what does the coach say? The coach is like, walk it off. Don't say that to her. But the coach is, it's not time for a pity party. Like, the coach is going to get really bossy, and the coach is going to say, like, this is not easy. You can do this. Temporary pain for some gain. Your team needs you. We're all behind you. Get out there and finish. You got this, you know? So here's what I want you to know. When she has the self-doubt signpost, she starts to not believe in herself. But that's when you pick up the energy and you believe in her for enough for both of you. And that's hard to do because you're kind of like, is she okay? You know what I mean? But you can be a little bit, like, thrown when you're like, is she okay? But I promise you, when she says that, like, self-doubt, and I'm going to show you a video next week that really illustrates, like, you're going to see women kind of losing it. But that's when she needs you to just bring a wall of energy to her. And that's what's going to really carry her to the end. Because how long does this last? Do you remember?
It's like 30 minutes. It's not long.
Right? It's actually really fast. I'm going to tell you, the more wild it is, the more like, ooh, crazy, the shorter it is. So it's 30 minutes to 2 hours, okay? But I really can tell you that, like, the more she's kind of panicking and crazy, actually the baby's probably just coming out now, you know?
You said that that self-doubt signpost doesn't happen if you have an epidural?
No, because, like, that surge of hormones, it doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier. It doesn't have the same, like, impact on your mood. And a lot of women will sleep at that time. But the way that it can affect you is, even though your body is numb and you're kind of sleeping, you can start to tremble and shake and feel jittery. Mm-hmm. So you might shake or feel uncomfortable, or you might have hot flashes or feel weird. You know? So, but because you can't feel your uterus like doing this whole flip-flop, it doesn't tend to be, you know, as panicky. So, yep. But your body's going through it for sure still. Any questions on this one before we move on? Okay. So you're kind of just getting the sense of, like, emotionally what she's needing at each phase, right? In phase one, it's like all fun and games and laughs and entertainment. In phase two, it's just staying close, but not worrying if she gets a little, I don't want to say hostile, but like if she gets a little testy, you know what I mean? And then phase three, like you just get right in her face, you don't take your eyes off her, and you say, you listen to me, I'm not going to leave you, I'm going to stay with you until the end, and we're going to do each of these contractions because we've only got a few left. One by one, we're knocking them out, and we're going to be done this soon. Let's do this. So you just get like really more, how do I put it, like you redouble your efforts. You like bring energy in and you just don't take your eyes off her. You're just like, you need intensive support, like we're doing this. If you have a mom or a doula there too, like if you need to go to the bathroom, they step in, they get right in her face, you know. If it's you, you're like right in her face. Someone, she doesn't do any contractions alone. She's just like getting lots of support, right? So that really helps. Okay. So I wanted to kind of cover the stages of labor again. Any questions on that before we move on to the next? Okay, good. So I want you to kind of see yourselves like dancing through these phases as you're going through these like gates and like moving to the next phase, right? And like kind of how will you act in these situations? When you have some ideas of what to do, it's going to really help you. And before you leave, you're going to have a cheat sheet of like 100 things you can do to bring her comfort. So don't worry, I'm not going to leave you hanging. You're going to have some good cheat sheets to take with you, okay? But kind of knowing the emotional tone is going to really help you help her. I can't say this enough. There's a bizarre fear in her that you're going to actually abandon her and leave her in the middle of the river. So the more you can say, I'm not leaving you, the more calm she's going to be. So, okay. We're going to move on to a talk about how to have a constructive conversation. We're going to review when to leave. When to leave for the hospital. Key stuff, right? Okay. Throw some things out at me. What are we looking for?
Water breaking.
Great.
What?
Great.
Bloody show?
Bloody show. Right on. Because bloody show shows you you're in labor. Not too much blood, but a little's good. If it's like a steady trickle, call the doctor. But if it's like kind of like a period or something like that, you're good. If it's spotting, you're good. Okay? Bloody show. What else?
I thought the rule was just that 411 thing.
Okay, so I like what you're saying. So the 411, which means the contractions are 4 minutes apart or less. And the contractions are 1 minute long or more.
For 1 hour.
Yep, for 1 hour. But remember, if she does this, how far will that dilate her?
Yeah.
1 centimeter. 1/2 to 1 centimeter. So if you leave right when that happens, you'll expect to get to the hospital and be like 0.5 centimeter dilated. Do you know what I'm saying? So it's okay to do this at home for a little bit to let it open her before you get there. So we're gonna add in that, which is good. That's on the list. We're gonna add in a couple more criteria to just show us she's actually like getting a little farther.
When and the mom says.
Yep. Right on. Mom says go. What else?
Vocalizing.
Nice. Vocalizing. Mooing like a cow. Whatever it takes. Okay? What else? Just remember, when you moo like a cow, I am proud of you. Okay? Do not embarrass. Okay, so vocalizing. What else?